Welcome to Jeremy's IT Lab. This is a free complete course for the CCNA. If you like these videos, please subscribe to follow along with the series. Also, please like and leave a comment and share the video to help spread this free series of videos. Thanks for your help. In this video, we'll cover two main topics, virtualization and cloud. They are mentioned in exam topic 1.2F, on-premises and cloud, and 1.12, explain virtualization fundamentals, virtual machines. Although they are separate topics, they are related because virtualization is an essential part of cloud services. If you want to really go in depth about these topics, consider looking into certifications from cloud providers like AWS, Azure, and GCP, or VMware certifications for virtualization. Here's what we'll cover in these videos. First, I'll give an introduction to virtualization, talking about virtual servers and virtual networks. Then I'll introduce cloud computing, talking about its essential characteristics, service models, and deployment models. Finally, I'll briefly talk about connecting to public clouds via the internet or a private WAN. And make sure to watch until the end of the video for a bonus practice question from Boson Software's XSIM for CCNA, the best practice exams for the CCNA. The first topic for today is virtual servers. But first, let's look at some server hardware. Although Cisco is more known for their networking devices, such as routers, switches, and firewalls, they also offer hardware servers, such as their UCS, Unified Computing System. Here are some examples of Cisco UCS servers. Although Cisco offers these hardware servers, the largest vendors of hardware servers include Dell EMC, HPE, which is Hewlett-Packard Enterprise, and IBM, but there are many other large vendors too. If you go to a data center, you'll see racks full of servers like these. Before talking about virtualization, let's see how servers work without virtualization. Before virtualization, there was a one-to-one relationship between a physical server and an operating system. In the diagram on the left, you can see that. On top of the server's hardware components, there is one operating system running. Perhaps it's a Linux server. In that operating system, apps providing services such as a web server, email server, etc. would run. Again, that is shown in the diagram. One physical server would be used for the web server, one for the email server, one for the database server, etc. Now, it is possible to run all servers in a single operating system on a single physical server, but this is not a good idea, because if the servers aren't isolated from each other, a problem on a single app could affect all of the other apps. However, using one physical server per app is inefficient for multiple reasons. First, each physical server is expensive and takes up space, power, etc. Also, the resources on each physical server, for example, CPU, RAM, storage, and NIC capacity, are typically underused. NIC means network interface card, by the way, the part of the server that connects to the network. This is how a traditional server operates. But with virtualization, it looks a bit different. Virtualization allows us to break the one-to-one relationship of hardware to OS, allowing multiple OSs to run on a single physical server. Each instance is called a VM, virtual machine. In the diagram on the left, three virtual machines are running on a single physical server. A hypervisor is used to manage and allocate the hardware resources, such as CPU and RAM, to each VM. Another name for a hypervisor is a VMM, Virtual Machine Monitor. The type of hypervisor which runs directly on top of the hardware is called a Type 1 hypervisor, and a couple examples are VMware ESXi and Microsoft Hyper-V. So the diagram on the left is an example of a server with a Type 1 hypervisor. It's running directly on top of the hardware. They are also called bare metal hypervisors because they run directly on the hardware, the metal. You might also hear them called native hypervisors. This is the type of hypervisor used in data center environments. They are efficient because the hypervisor runs directly on the hardware and requires few resources itself, leaving more for the VMs running on the hypervisor. But let's look at the other type of hypervisor, type 2. Type 2 hypervisors run as a program on an operating system, like a regular computer program. Examples include VMware Workstation and Oracle VirtualBox. You can download these and run them on your home PC or laptop, and then run VMs inside. The OS running directly on the hardware is called the host OS, and the OS running in a VM is called a guest OS. In the diagram on the left, there is a host OS running some apps, including a Type 2 hypervisor. And on top of the hypervisor, there are two VMs running a guest OS, with their own apps running inside. Another name for a Type 2 hypervisor is hosted hypervisor. Although Type 2 hypervisors are rarely used in data center environments, they are common on personal use devices. For example, if a Mac or Linux user needs to run an app that is only supported on Windows or vice versa. In fact, for the next lab video, we'll download a free Type 2 hypervisor and then run a virtual machine inside of it. Okay, so now you know the absolute basics of virtualization, Type 1 and Type 2 hypervisors. But why should we use virtualization? I think there's no better place to look for answers than the king of virtualization, VMware. So here is some information directly from VMware's site. Virtualization provides partitioning, so you can run multiple operating systems on one physical machine and divide the system resources between them. This solves the problem of hardware resource underuse, which I mentioned earlier. Virtualization also provides isolation, for example, fault isolation. Remember I said it's a bad idea to have all of your servers running on a single OS in a single physical server? By running each server in a separate virtual machine, they are isolated and can't affect each other if a fault occurs. Virtualization also provides encapsulation, so you can easily save a VM, move it around, and copy it as easily as a regular file. Virtualization also provides hardware independence, so you can create or move any VM to any physical server. As long as the hypervisor you are using can run on the physical server, it doesn't matter what kind of VM you run on top of that hypervisor. And here is a graphic, again from VMware. Virtualization provides reduced capital costs because you need fewer physical servers, as well as reduced operating costs because fewer physical servers means less space, power, and cooling is needed. VMs also require less work to set up, which is another reduction in operating costs. Downtime can be reduced or eliminated because it's easy to deploy a VM to multiple physical servers for redundancy. VMs also provide increased productivity, efficiency, agility, and responsiveness. That sounds like a bunch of buzzwords, and I'm not going to explain each one, one by one. But VMs are definitely more efficient and agile compared to traditional physical-only servers. Speed is also a big benefit. It's much quicker to add a new VM than ask your boss for approval to order a new physical server, order the server, wait for it to arrive, mount it on the rack, connect the cables, configure it, etc. Now, regarding virtual networks, I'm just going to briefly explain how VMs can connect to each other and to the external network, outside of the physical host. VMs are connected to each other and the external network via a virtual switch running on the hypervisor. The hypervisor will provide a virtual switch to use, or alternatively, you can run a Cisco virtual switch on the hypervisor, for example. Just like a regular switch, the vSwitch's interfaces can run as access or trunk ports and use VLANs to separate the VMs at layer 2. Notice that in this example, two of the VMs are in VLAN 10 and one is in VLAN 20. Interfaces on the virtual switch then connect to the physical NIC or NICs of the server to communicate with the external network. Now look at the connection between the physical NICs of the server and the physical switches. We can use a VPC, virtual port channel, to form a port channel to two separate physical switches for redundancy. This is not something you have to know for the CCNA. I just wanted to point it out, because it's commonly used in data centers. Okay, that's all about virtualization for now. Virtualization is a huge topic in modern day IT, and although you don't have to be a virtualization specialist, you definitely do have to know about it. So let's finally get into cloud. Traditional IT infrastructure deployments were some combination of the following. First, on-premises. This means that all servers, network devices, and other infrastructure are located on company property. from the desktops to the routers, firewalls, web servers, database servers, etc. All equipment is purchased and owned by the company using it, and they are also responsible for the space, power, and cooling required for the devices. Another option is co-location. Data centers that rent out space for customers to put their infrastructure, such as their servers and network devices. Of course, devices such as desktops, wireless access points, etc., are still in the company's building, but servers and most network infrastructure will be in the colocation data center. The data center provides the space, electricity, and cooling for the devices in the data center. In addition to that, they provide the physical security as well. The servers, network devices, etc., are still the responsibility of the end customer, although they are not located on the customer's premises. So, traditionally, a company would use on-premises, or a combination of on-premises and co-location. But cloud services provide an alternative that is hugely popular nowadays, and is continuing to grow. Now, most people associate cloud with public cloud providers such as AWS. And although this is the most common use of cloud services, it's not the only one. So let's look at what cloud computing actually is. The American NIST, National Institute of Standards and Technology, defined cloud computing in Special Publication 800-145. It's free to read here. It's a very short document. The PDF is 7 pages, but the actual content is only 2 pages, so I highly recommend reading it. Actually, for this part of the video, I'll mostly be quoting from this document and giving a bit more explanation. First, here is the NIST's definition of cloud computing. Cloud computing is a model for enabling ubiquitous, convenient, on-demand network access to a shared pool of configurable computing resources, for example, networks, servers, storage, applications, and services, that can be rapidly provisioned and released with minimal management effort or service provider interaction. This cloud model is composed of 5 essential characteristics, 3 service models, and 4 deployment models. Pause the video and take some time to read it slowly. It's important. Now, to help understand the above definition, to understand what the cloud is, let's look at the following outlined in SP 800-145. The 5 essential characteristics, the 3 service models, and the 4 deployment models of cloud. Basically, these are what Cisco expects you to know about cloud for the CCNA exam. You don't need to know about specific services offered by specific cloud providers. If you have a basic understanding of these 5 essential characteristics, 3 service models, and 4 deployment models, you'll be set. These are the 5 essential characteristics of cloud computing. If a service has some of these characteristics, but not all, it will generally not be considered a true cloud service. The characteristics are on-demand self-service, broad network access, resource pooling, rapid elasticity, and measured service. Let's briefly look at each of those. First, on-demand self-service. Here is the NIST's definition. A consumer can unilaterally provision computing capabilities, such as server time and network storage, as needed automatically, without requiring human interaction with each service provider. So the customer is able to use the service, or stop using the service, freely through a web portal, without directly interacting with the service provider. To set up some virtual servers on AWS, Amazon Web Services, you don't have to contact AWS, ask them to send you a quote for 5 virtual servers, send them the payment, and then wait for the servers to be set up. You log into the web portal and do it all yourself. No need to interact with anyone at AWS. Next, broad network access. Here's the NIST's explanation. Capabilities are available over the network and accessed through standard mechanisms that promote use by heterogeneous thin or thick client platforms, for example, mobile phones, tablets, laptops, and workstations. So the service is available through standard network connections, for example, the internet or private WAN connections, and can be accessed through many kinds of devices. Speaking about AWS again, you can access their web portal through a PC, smartphone, or any device that connects to the internet. And if you provision a virtual server on AWS, you can connect to it over the internet or through a variety of other WAN options. Next, resource pooling. the provider's computing resources are pooled to serve multiple consumers using a multi-tenant model, with different physical and virtual resources dynamically assigned and reassigned according to consumer demand. There is a sense of location independence, in that the customer generally has no control or knowledge over the exact location of the provided resources, but may be able to specify location at a higher level of abstraction, for example, country, state, or data center. Examples of resources include storage, processing, memory, and network bandwidth. To summarize, a pool of resources is provided by the service provider, and when a customer requests a service, for example, creates a new VM, the resources to fulfill that request are allocated from the shared pool. Inside of AWS's data centers, they have tons of storage drives, servers with tons of CPU and RAM, etc. This is a shared pool of resources used by AWS customers. When you create a VM on AWS, it is assigned a portion of those shared resources. Next is rapid elasticity. Capabilities can be elastically provisioned and released, in some cases automatically, to scale rapidly outward and inward, commensurate with demand. To the consumer, the capabilities available for provisioning often appear to be unlimited and can be appropriated in any quantity at any time. To summarize, customers can quickly expand the services they use in the cloud, for example, add new VMs, expand storage, etc., from a pool of resources that appears to be infinite. If you need to add 100 new servers right now, AWS isn't going to tell you, "Sorry, we don't have enough resources for you to do that." Of course, the resource pool isn't infinite, but it should be large enough to appear infinite to the customer. And in addition to quickly expanding their use of services, a customer should be able to quickly reduce their use of services when they don't need them. Here's the last of the five essential characteristics, measured service. Cloud systems automatically control and optimize resource use by leveraging a metering capability at some level of abstraction appropriate to the type of service. For example, storage, processing, bandwidth, and active user accounts. Resource usage can be monitored, controlled, and reported, providing transparency for both the provider and customer of the utilized service. So, the cloud service provider measures the customer's usage of cloud resources, and the customer can measure their own use as well. A customer should never be surprised by a big bill at the end of the month, because their usage is clearly visible within the web portal. And customers are charged based on usage, for example, X dollars per gigabyte of storage per day. Okay, those are the five essential characteristics of cloud computing: on-demand self-service, broad network access, resource pooling, rapid elasticity, and measured service. You definitely should have a basic understanding of these for the CCNA. Next, the three service models of cloud. In cloud computing, everything is provided on a service model. For example, rather than the end user buying a physical server, mounting it on a rack, installing the hypervisor, creating the VMs, etc., the service provider offers all of this as a service. There are a variety of services referred to as something as a service, something AAS. The three main service models of cloud computing, as defined by the NIST, are Software as a Service, SaaS, Platform as a Service, PaaS, and Infrastructure as a Service, IaaS. Let's look at each one. First, Software as a Service, SaaS. As defined by the NIST, the capability provided to the customer is to use the provider's applications running on a cloud infrastructure. The applications are accessible from various client devices through either a thin client interface, such as a web browser, for example, web-based email, or a program interface. The customer does not manage or control the underlying cloud infrastructure, including network, servers, operating systems, storage, or even individual application capabilities, with the possible exception of limited user-specific application configuration settings. Microsoft Office 365 is a popular example of SaaS. It's Microsoft Office, Word, PowerPoint, Excel, etc., provided over Microsoft's cloud infrastructure. But there are other examples, such as Google's G Suite, which includes Gmail. This image from Microsoft might help you understand. When you're using software as a service, the service provider is basically in control of everything, from the physical data center to the networks in the data center, to the servers, the operating systems on the servers, all tools running on the operating systems, and the applications themselves. The end user, the customer, simply uses the application, for example, Excel running on Office 365, as provided by the service provider. Next is Platform as a Service, PaaS. As defined by the NIST, the capability provided to the consumer is to deploy onto the cloud infrastructure consumer-created or acquired applications created using programming languages, libraries, services, and tools supported by the provider. The consumer does not manage or control the underlying cloud infrastructure, including network, servers, operating systems, or storage, but has control over the deployed applications and possibly configuration settings for the application hosting environment. Basically, the service provider offers a platform for developers to use to make applications. For example, AWS Lambda and Google App Engine are two popular offerings. In the case of PaaS, the service provider is in control of the data centers, the networking and security, the servers and storage, and operating systems on the servers, as well as the tools running on the operating systems. This provides a platform that the customer can use to develop their own applications. So notice that the hosted applications on the left of the diagram are not included within the scope of Platform as a Service. Finally, there is Infrastructure as a Service, IaaS. As defined by the NIST, the capability provided to the consumer is to provision processing, storage, networks, and other fundamental computing resources where the consumer is able to deploy and run arbitrary software, which can include operating systems and applications. The consumer does not manage or control the underlying cloud infrastructure, but has control over operating systems, storage, and deployed applications, and possibly limited control of select networking components, for example, host firewalls. In earlier examples, I mentioned making VMs on AWS. Well, that is an example of IaaS. Examples of IaaS services include Amazon EC2 and Google Compute Engine. So the service provider takes care of the physical data center, the network and security, and server and storage infrastructure. This provides infrastructure that the customer can use for basically any purpose they want. So IaaS offers the most control to the customer. The service provider just offers the underlying infrastructure. So here are those three service models of cloud computing once again. Software as a service, platform as a service, and infrastructure as a service. These days, you'll hear a lot of other kinds of something as a service, but these three form the foundation of cloud services. Now let's look at the final group of concepts, the four deployment models of cloud. Most people assume that cloud means public cloud providers such as AWS, Azure, and GCP. Although it is true that this is the most common cloud deployment model, it's not the only one. Here are the four deployment models of cloud computing: private, community, public, and hybrid. Let's examine each one. First up, private cloud. According to the NIST, the cloud infrastructure is provisioned for exclusive use by a single organization comprising multiple consumers, for example, business units. It may be owned, managed, and operated by the organization, a third party, or some combination of them, and it may exist on or off premises. Private clouds are generally only used by large enterprises or government organizations. Although the cloud is private, meaning exclusively used by a single organization, it may be owned by a third party. For example, AWS provides private cloud services for the American Department of Defense. The infrastructure is Amazon's, but it's reserved for use by the DoD. Private clouds may be on or off premises. This is important. Many people assume that cloud and on-prem are two different things, but that is not always the case. In a private cloud, the same kinds of services are offered as in public clouds: software, platform, and infrastructure as a service. But the infrastructure that forms the cloud is reserved for a single organization. Next, community cloud. According to the NIST, the cloud infrastructure is provisioned for exclusive use by a specific community of consumers from organizations that have shared concerns, for example, mission, security requirements, policy, and compliance considerations. It may be owned, managed, and operated by one or more of the organizations in the community, a third party, or some combination of them, and it may exist on or off premises. This is the least common cloud deployment. It's similar to private cloud, but the infrastructure is reserved for use by only a specific group of organizations. Now we have the most popular one, public cloud. According to the NIST, the cloud infrastructure is provisioned for open use by the general public. It may be owned, managed, and operated by a business, academic, or government organization, or some combination of them. It exists on the premises of the cloud provider. This is by far the most common cloud deployment. Here are some popular public cloud providers: AWS, Azure, GCP, OCI, IBM, and Alibaba all offer popular public cloud services, although AWS has been a dominant number one for a long time. Finally, we have hybrid cloud. According to the NIST, the cloud infrastructure is a composition of two or more distinct cloud infrastructures, private, community, or public, that remain unique entities but are bound together by standardized or proprietary technology that enables data and application portability, for example, cloud bursting for load balancing between clouds. So this is basically any combination of the previous three deployment types, rather than a totally unique kind of cloud deployment. An example is a private cloud, which can offload to a public cloud when necessary, due to resource restrictions. Okay, here's a summary of the four deployment models: private cloud, community cloud, public cloud, and hybrid cloud. Make sure you know the basic definition of each of these deployment types. So, we covered a lot of concepts about the cloud. Here's a summary of all of them. Keep in mind that the NIST definition of cloud computing was originally published in 2011, and cloud computing is an always evolving set of technologies. However, the concepts outlined in the document are the foundational concepts of cloud computing that are still true today. So, as I said before, you should have a general understanding of the five essential characteristics, three service models, and four deployment models of cloud computing. Now, I introduced a lot of cloud concepts, and you can probably imagine some of the benefits of using the cloud, but let me briefly introduce just a few benefits. First is cost. The CapEx, capital expenses, of buying hardware and software, setting up data centers, etc., are reduced or eliminated when using the cloud. Now, instead, the expenses are OpEx, operating expenses, meaning regular small costs instead of one-time large costs. For many companies, the cloud provides an overall cost reduction, although of course it can depend on the situation. Cloud services are also very easy to scale globally at a rapid pace. Services can be set up and offered to customers from a geographic location close to them. When you create a virtual server in AWS, for example, you can choose the country as well as the region within the country, which can provide better service for those in the country or region. Cloud services also offer speed and agility. As I mentioned earlier, services are provided on demand, and vast amounts of resources can be provisioned within minutes. Productivity can also be improved. Cloud services remove the need for many time-consuming tasks, such as procuring physical servers, racking them, cabling, installing and updating operating systems, etc. This can also further lead to reduced costs. Another benefit is reliability. Backups in the cloud are very easy, and data can be mirrored, meaning copied, at multiple different geographic locations to support disaster recovery. If one server dies, that's okay because there's a copy somewhere else. Now, although I list these as benefits of the cloud, keep in mind that it doesn't mean that the cloud is always the best option. Most companies these days use a combination of on-premises equipment, colocation, and public cloud. So think of this as a partial list of potential benefits, not a complete list of absolute benefits. A company shouldn't use the cloud just because it's popular these days. They should weigh the benefits and drawbacks and make an informed decision. Finally, let me briefly introduce how an enterprise might connect their network to resources on a public cloud. Since we already covered WAN technologies in the previous video, this will be very brief. I just want to point out that there are multiple ways a company can connect to their resources on a public cloud. For example, through a private WAN such as an MPLS VPN. Another option is to simply connect via the internet. This is very cheap, flexible, and easy. But of course, connecting through the internet is not as secure as a private WAN connection. So a VPN can be used to provide a secure connection over the internet to the resources on the cloud. Okay, that's all I have to say about connections to the cloud. Just be aware that since these resources are not on your premises, it's not enough to just set up the apps and servers. You also have to think about how to securely connect to them. And just like regular WAN connections, redundant connections are always preferable. Having a single point of failure, which can take down a network, is never a good thing. Okay, before moving on to the quiz, let's review what we covered. First, I introduced virtualization, including Type 1 and Type 2 hypervisors. I spoke mostly about virtual servers, but briefly mentioned how virtual switches are used to connect VMs to other VMs and to the external network. Then I introduced cloud computing. Make sure you learn those essential characteristics, service models, and deployment models of cloud computing. Those are the fundamentals of the cloud that Cisco expects you to know for the CCNA exam. Finally, I briefly introduced how to connect to the cloud. Basically, any of the WAN options introduced in the previous video can also be used to connect to resources on the cloud. Make sure to watch until the end of the quiz for a bonus question from Boson Software's XSIM for CCNA, the best practice exams for the CCNA. Okay, let's go to quiz question 1. Which statement about virtual machines is true? Pause the video now to read the options and select the best answer. Okay, the answer is A. The hypervisor is used to manage and allocate hardware resources to VMs. This is the main role of the hypervisor. As for B and C, the two definitions are reversed. Type 2 hypervisors run on a host OS, and Type 1 hypervisors run directly on top of the hardware. And many VMs can exist on a single physical server, so D is incorrect. Okay, let's go to question 2. Which of the following hypervisor types is known as a native hypervisor? Pause the video now to select the best answer. Okay, the answer is A, Type 1. Type 1 hypervisors are known as native hypervisors, whereas Type 2 hypervisors are known as hosted hypervisors. Type 3 hypervisors don't exist, at least not as a widely accepted term. Okay, let's go to question 3. Which of the following is not an essential characteristic of cloud computing? Pause the video now to select the answer. Okay, the answer is D, infinite resource pool. Although cloud services should allow customers to expand their resources so that it appears as if the available pool is infinite, in reality, it is of course not infinite. The other options here are essential characteristics of cloud computing. The only one missing is on-demand self-service. Okay, let's go to question 4. Which of the following cloud service types allows customers to use applications running on the provider's cloud infrastructure? Pause the video to select the best answer. Okay, the answer is C, SaaS, Software as a Service. This image shows the scope of SaaS, PaaS, and IaaS. In SaaS, the provider provides everything, ranging from the data center infrastructure all the way to the app itself, and the customer pays to use the app. Okay, let's go to question 5. Which of the following cloud deployment types may exist off-premises? Pause the video now to select the best answer. Okay, the answer is D, all of the above. Whether the cloud is public, private, community, or a hybrid, they all can, and usually do, exist off-premises. But keep in mind that cloud doesn't always mean off-premises. Private clouds in particular may be on-premises, within a building owned or operated by the company using the cloud. Although off-premises is much more common for cloud deployments, keep in mind it's not the only option. Okay, that's all for the quiz. Now let's take a look at a bonus question in Boson Software's XSIM for CCNA. Okay, here's today's Boson XSIM practice question. Which of the following examples best describes the SaaS service model? Select the best answer. Okay, there are four options. Pause the video now and select the best answer. Okay, let's check. First, A. A company obtains a subscription to use a service provider's infrastructure, programming tools, and programming languages to develop and serve cloud-based applications. Okay, that does not sound like software as a service. That is platform as a service. How about B? A company licenses an office suite, including email service, that is delivered to the end user through a web browser. Okay, that does sound like SaaS, software as a service. This sounds exactly like Microsoft Office 365, which is an office suite delivered to the end user through a web browser. Okay, so I think the correct answer is B. Let's check the others. A company hires a service provider to deliver cloud-based processing and storage that will house multiple virtual hosts. Okay, so this is not software as a service. This is infrastructure as a service. And D, a company moves all company-wide policy documents to an internet-based virtual file system hosted by a service provider. Okay, this also sounds like infrastructure as a service. So I think the correct answer is B. I'll click on show answer, and indeed that is the correct answer. So you can read Boson's explanation here, explaining SaaS, PaaS, and IaaS. Okay, so hopefully you read that. And it has some references, including to that NIST document that I explained in the video, 800-145. Again, I highly recommend reading this. Okay, so that was a quick look at Boson Software's XSIM for CCNA. These are my recommended practice exams for the CCNA, and they are by far the best. If you want to get Boson XSIM, please follow the link in the video description. There are supplementary materials for this video. There is a flashcard deck to use with the software Anki. There will also be a practice lab. This time will be a bit different. I'll walk you through how to download a free Type 2 hypervisor, Oracle VirtualBox, and then run a virtual machine in it. That will be in the next video. To get the free flashcards and lab files for the course, sign up at the link in the video description. Before finishing today's video, I want to thank my JCNP level channel members. To join, please click the join button under the video. Thank you to Pietrocious, Joseph, Qua, Dragos, Tanvir, Charlzetta, Gerard, Tom, Samil, Scott, Martin, Tebogo, Pavel, Abraham, Sergey, Njoku, Victor, Suki, Kenneth, Seamus, Brandon, Marcel, Kone, Donald, Gustavo, Prakash, Nasir, Erlison, Marco, Ed, John, Funny Dart, Velva Jacob, Boson Software, Devin, Jonathan, and Vance. Sorry if I pronounced your name incorrectly, but thank you so much for your support. This is the list of JCNP level members at the time of recording, by the way, July 25th, 2021. If you signed up recently and your name isn't on here, don't worry, you'll be in future videos. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe to the channel, like the video, leave a comment, and share the video with anyone else studying for the CCNA. If you want to leave a tip, check the links in the description. I'm also a Brave verified publisher and accept BAT or Basic Attention Token tips via the Brave browser. That's all for now.